Welcome to another MedCram lecture. We're going to talk about ventilator pearls today. If you haven't done any work on the ventilator, look at our other lecture on ventilator explained clearly, and there's a link there for that. What today's lecture is going to be on is just some different vignettes about things that I use in general when I'm going to put someone on a ventilator, and I call this ventilator pearls. So the first thing I'm going to talk about is just when you put someone on a ventilator in general. When you put someone on a ventilator, you have to know what's going to happen to their pressure, specifically their intrapleural pressure. So if you look at the lung here, they sit in a cavity called the thoracic cage, and there's a pressure associated with this space between the lungs and the chest wall. So if we could measure that, and we would see it on a transducer, we would notice something. That when someone is breathing spontaneously, what's going to happen is their diaphragm is going to contract, and instead of it being a nice dome, it's going to contract down, and it's going to cause the intrapleural pressure to go down. Okay? That's very important, because when the intrapleural pressure goes down, the lungs are going to get bigger, and therefore air is going to be sucked in. Key word there is sucked in, because there's a negative pressure. Okay? That's how you breathe in a spontaneous fashion. Okay? And then when you release, the air comes back up and back to zero again. So that's zero. In the situation where you have positive pressure ventilation, so you're putting someone on a ventilator, just the opposite happens. You're at a neutral level here. And then the ventilator goes ahead and pushes air, not sucks, but pushes air into your lung. And that's going to make a positive pressure in that pleural space. So you can see here that when you put someone from spontaneous breathing on a ventilator, they're going to go from negative pressure ventilation to positive pressure ventilation. By the way, the same thing happens if they're on BiPAP or CPAP. It's just that they're not intubated. But when they're intubated, it's even more so, because you've inflated the cuff and you're basically pushing that air, and you can measure the pressures. So this is positive pressure ventilation. So you just got to be aware of that, because there's consequences to that. And here's one of the biggest consequences to that. Let's just draw this schematically here. Imagine we've got the heart here. And we know that the right atrium is where all the venous return comes back to. And here the pressure is fairly low. Let's say it's 0 to 5 millimeters of mercury, okay? And the reason why blood flows back here is because the blood in the venous system is actually higher, okay? So it's actually higher than it is in the right atrium. And as a result, you know, things go from a high pressure to a low pressure. You've got blood flowing back. So this is venous return going back this way, and that's the flow that it's going at. Well, here's the problem. When you put someone on positive pressure ventilation, this heart is also in that thoracic cage with the lungs. And so what happens is, if you are putting someone from spontaneous breathing to on a ventilator, where you go from essentially negative pressure ventilation to positive pressure ventilation, the general average pressure in the heart is going to go up, because the heart is sitting in that very space. And so as a result of that, your right atrial pressure also goes up. So let's say it goes up to here. Now, if that's the case, that means the slope of this return is not going to be as steep as it was. And so your venous return is actually going to drop slightly, okay? Now, if that's the case, if your venous return drops, you know that the heart can only pump what it's given, right? So cardiac output is also going to drop, and that is going to drop blood pressure. Incidentally, the same thing happens when you're talking about positive and expiratory pressure, or PEEP. So PEEP is going to accentuate that. So where would this come in handy? This is a patient who is septic. Let's think about this. Let's think about a septic patient. this is a patient specifically whose venous return is going to be pretty low already. And they're septic. They've got a metabolic acidosis. They're looking kind of ill. You may need to intubate them. So what's the thing that you're going to do? You look at their blood pressure and it's maybe marginal. You've got to know that as soon as you intubate this patient, this is going to go up. Their venous return is going to drop and their blood pressure is going to drop. So in these patients, if I have time before I have to intubate them, if they don't look like they have to be intubated right away, the first thing I do is make sure I've got good IV access or even put in a central line and be ready to go with vasopressors. You always got to think 2 to 3 steps ahead in these patients. So in septic patients, I'm looking at them, they're going downhill. If they don't have a central line, they're not intubated. I would rather put the central line in first and then intubate them, because if I intubate them and their pressure drops, I've got access. Also, if I've got the central line in, I can actually measure this pressure and I can start working on getting it up so that when I do intubate, I don't get that drop in pressure, because these drops in pressure can cause problems with the kidneys and et cetera. So septic patient, make sure I've got IV access, make sure I've got a central line in place, and then go ahead and intubate. Okay, so that's just a pearl there when it comes to understanding heart-lung interaction and the fact that the heart is in the thoracic cage and it's affected by intrapleural pressures. The next thing I want to talk about is with metabolic acidosis, and we kind of alluded to this. So probably the same septic patient we were talking about before, but if they've got a metabolic acidosis. And I've seen this actually commonly. Okay, you got to be careful with this. So let's pick a really bad blood gas. Let's say their blood gas is 7.20, 20, 60, and something horrendous like, 15. I don't even know if this blood gas works or not, but it's pretty low. Okay, so what we know here, and if you want to know more about this, go to our acid-base lectures, and there's a link for our acid-base lecture. You know that if the first two digits after the decimal point of the pH are equal to the CO2, then what you have here is a pure metabolic acidosis that's compensated respiratory-wise. So you can see here that normally our PCO2 level, so by the way, this is pH, this is PCO2, this is PO2, and this is the bicarb. You can hear that our PCO2, which is normally 40, has dropped down to 20. And that's because the lung is trying to compensate for this acidosis by breathing off a Lewis acid in the form of carbon dioxide. So let's say this patient's crashing and you put the central line in and you're giving IV fluids and then you go and intubate them. You may want to look at the respiratory rate and the tidal volume before you intubated the patient, because if the vital signs on that patient are, let's say, respiratory rate of 30, and tidal volume, let's say it wasn't that great. Let's say it was 400, okay? If you go ahead and intubate that patient and sedate that patient and maybe even paralyze that patient and you dial in your regular vent settings of AC of 12, tidal volume of 450, and let's say a PEEP of 5 and an FiO2 of 100%, these are kind of generalized vent settings that people use when they intubate people, right? Look at your alveolar ventilation there. Okay, take a look at that. That's around an alveolar ventilation of 12 liters per minute. Okay, so that patient's pushing it hard, right? Trying to get it done. Whereas down here, what's this alveolar ventilation? We're just simply multiplying 12 times 0.450 and we get 5.4 liters per minute. So what you've done here is you had a patient who was in metabolic acidosis and was trying to compensate for that by breathing hard to get the pH up to 7.20, because if they weren't breathing this hard, the pH would be a lot lower. And this is what they're doing. This is what they're doing, 12. And then you sedate them, paralyze them, and you put them on vent settings of this. What's going to happen? They're not going to be blowing off as much carbon dioxide, and this pH is going to drop into the 6.9, which is going to lead to cardiac arrest. Okay? So think about that in a patient who is really severely metabolic, is going downhill, they're breathing hard, and then you intubate them. Because if you do not match these vent settings as appropriately as you possibly can, you're going to get this drop in pH. So I don't set the respiratory rate to 30, not unless there's severe circumstances. I may go up to 20, and I may increase the tidal volume. But the key there is to get a blood gas pretty quick, follow up on your pH, and make sure you're moving in the right direction. If you've got a patient without COPD, you're not going to really be too worried about the ventilator rate, okay? But here's the key. The key point with this is you want to continue the same amount of alveolar ventilation, if possible, before the ventilator as after the ventilator. Okay, and so the last pearl I want to talk about is someone that comes in with COPD. Let's say it's gold stage 4. And by that, I mean the FEV1 is less than 30% of predicted. Look at our COPD lectures. There's a link. Or the PCO2, and here's the key. The PCO2 is greater than 45. If your PCO2 on a patient with COPD is greater than 45, they've got chronic respiratory failure, okay? PCO2 should be less than 45. If it's greater than 45, then you're dealing with chronic respiratory acidosis. So let's imagine we've got somebody who is in that situation. They've got chronic respiratory acidosis. And so a blood gas would look like that: 7.34, 60, 55, and let's say a bicarb of 30. Okay? So there's your chronic respiratory acidosis. Now, here's the thing. You know that they've got chronic respiratory acidosis because their CO2 is high. Remember, normal PCO2 should be about 40. Yet, in somebody who had a PCO2 of 60 and it was acute, their blood gas would look more like this: 7.26, 60, 55, and their bicarb would be more like, 26. So notice, this is chronic and this is acute. And again, if you need more review on this, you can go to the acid-base lectures that we had, and there's a link on that. So PCO2 is high in both of these situations. In this situation, the patient has not had enough time for their kidneys to hold on to that bicarbonate. And as a result, the kidneys cannot compensate for the respiratory acidosis. Therefore, the pH drops more substantially. In the chronic case, the PCO2 went from 40 up to 60 over a long period of time because of the COPD, for instance. And as a result, the kidney has had the ability to retain more bicarbonate in the body. And as a result of that, the pH is more close to normal, which is 7.35 to 7.45. Here's the point with the ventilator. If you have a patient that comes in with chronic respiratory acidosis, their bicarbs are going to be high. You can tell that as soon as they come in. In fact, you can just get a Chem-7 and look at the bicarb and see that they're a chronic CO2 retainer because they're going to be in the mid-30s or 40s. In those situations, it's very important that when you put them on the ventilator, you don't blow their CO2 down to 40. What you're trying to do is you're trying to blow their CO2 down. So let's say they're normally at 60, but because they had a COPD exacerbation on top of their chronic COPD, it went up to 80, okay? So they come in with 80 and you put them on the ventilator and you're trying to figure out how much do I need to ventilate them. Don't ventilate them down to 40. Okay, because if you ventilate them down to 40 and they're on the ventilator for any extended period of time, guess what's going to happen to this bicarb? Body's going to say, well, we're ventilating at 40. We can dump this bicarb. So it's going to dump the bicarb. And when it dumps the bicarb down to 24, and then you try to get these patients off the ventilator, now they've got to start retaining this bicarb again, and they're not going to be able to do it quickly enough, and they're going to go into respiratory failure. So what do you do if you have a patient who you know has got chronic COPD? And the reason why you know that is not because of the CO2 that they come in with, but it's the bicarb that they've adjusted to over the period before. What you do is you ventilate them to normalize the pH. And you'll see this over and over again. In these patients, you've normalized the pH 7.35 to 7.45, but yet you'll notice that the CO2s are still elevated. That's okay. That's where they live. and you can try to wean them off the ventilator from there. Some helpful hints. Thanks for joining us.